Hello everybody and welcome back to Might and Magic Duel of Champions. Today, it's Wednesday, April 22nd, 2015, and it's time of renewal. Yeah, mind the date, because it's fairly important, because... Wow, since the last week, so many things happened, so many things are going on just right now, that oh my god, once again, oh my god. First of all, remember how last week I said that there's this Zorn's Revenge, and that I totally don't care about it, and that I'm gonna take a look at it later. So actually, I kinda did. Yeah, I did kinda investigate it, and that's because well, it's not in here anymore, but we'll do it the other way. Something like this showed up in the launcher. The same message was available down there in the news feed, but oh well. I'm never really paying attention to this news feed down there. So yeah, screw this. I saw it in the launcher in the first place anyway, and it was this message saying that intercepted messenger Pigeon and a ciphertext underneath. The very second I saw it, I was like, oh my god, it's a cipher, let's crack it. Yep, let's crack it, I wanna know what it means. So I looked at this text and I was like, let's try Caesar's cipher. Well, yeah, Caesar's cipher seems like the best thing to start with anything that looks like this. The more or less regular ciphertext that looks kinda like a regular text, but the letters are disorganized or something like this. So I wasn't even sure if it's gonna work with the Caesar cipher, nor I knew the number for the Caesar cipher that would be needed. So I was just like, okay, I've found a random online available Caesar cipher deciphering tool, and I was like, oh crap, I cannot copy from the launcher. Oh, I'll have to type it all manually. And I am so freaking lazy. Yes, I am, I admit. I was just too lazy to type it all in there. I just typed the first word here that goes up to this comma. And I was like, okay, let's try to go through all the possible combinations for the Caesars. If anything is okay in the Caesars, if I'll found that any combination leads to a normal regular English word, then it's gonna be Caesars, and I'm gonna type the rest of it, and I'm gonna crack it. If none of the Caesars possibilities, none of the numbers of the thing, will work, then it probably means that it's not Caesars, it's something more complicated, and I'll have to figure out a different way to crack it. Honestly, I expected it to be something with a keyword. I don't know why I had this sort of feeling from the very beginning that it may need a keyword, but I tried with the Caesars. And you know what? No results. I've run through all the combinations possible for Caesar's cipher, and nothing worked. So I was like, oh crap, okay. I've spent like, I don't know, a few hours of my precious life trying to crack this code. At the very end, I was like, okay, screw this, I can't do shit about this. I don't know how to deal with it. I entered the UB forums, and apparently it turns out that it had to be done with the Caesar's cipher. The thing is, the first word here was the hero's name, and by god, when I saw it the first time, it's like I saw a random letters. It wasn't any word in English that I particularly knew, yeah, because it was the name of the hero. So I couldn't do anything about it. Yeah, but then when it turned out that, yeah, someone just said on the forums that it should be done with Caesar's cipher. Actually, they've mentioned that it should be done with Rot 13, which is basically the same thing as Caesar's cipher. No difference at all. I just typed the whole text again in. I deciphered it, and apparently it was a text. And honestly, I'm not gonna spoil it to you. If you want, you can just go to the to the UB forums and then find it yourself, because people were spamming it all over the place. If you want, you can try to crack it yourself. I haven't told you the number for the cipher, so you can still have a little bit of fun trying to guess what number you'd have to use in Caesar's. Though you know it's Caesar's cipher, so not much fun. Well, basically it's related to what is the Zorn's Revenge, which actually is not in here anymore as well. Well, what is Zorn's Revenge then? Well, basically it's some sort of community event. And it goes like the story behind it, that Zorm's Abyssal Worms has been slain and Zorm is looking for the one who did it. And he has a list of 20, as far as I can remember, potential victims. And from 8th of April to 21st of April, which is yesterday, all around the Duel of Champions related places there are names in some way dropped. And there was a crossword, I think. There was this intercepted message. And other stuff I don't really remember at this particular moment. But basically, each of these messages contained the name of one hero. And by crossing them out of the list, because those mentioned names were the innocent heroes, you will be able to find the one guilty hero. And why I'm still mentioning it? Because till the 24th, as far as I can remember, which is probably Friday. So by April 24th, you are still able to go and send your answer. It's basically, you can find the details on the UB forums, but it basically PM BB Mommy and with the answer. BB Mommy is one of community managers for, actually it's English community, English forums. So that's the thing. If you feel like playing with the Zorn's Revenge, you can still go browse the forums, browse the Facebook, Twitter, and you have, thanks to me, the screenshot of this launcher with this intercepted PGL message. You can find out yourself what is there, and you may try to win. There are some few fancy things to win, or are they? Well, basically the main prize, like the creme de la creme of the whole prizes, is the figure of Zorm on one of his Abyssal Worms. Really nice thing. It's like I'm already like halfway through or so with those names. I'll probably try to deal with them today or maybe tomorrow, and hopefully I'll be able to say who is guilty in the on the 24th. If not, then I'll probably just take a wild stab and I'll just randomly put in one of the remaining names, because I haven't crossed out all of them yet. So okay, that's for the Zorn's Revenge. The next thing we have, let's go the usual, aka the Infernal Pit cards. Well, this week, yesterday we had Hall of Memories, really nice card, and tomorrow, no, on Friday, not tomorrow, 2 days from tomorrow. One day from tomorrow, 2 days from today. On Friday we'll have Mother Namtarin, Walker of Death. So, quick look at these cards. Hall of Memories, I'm too lazy to type it all in. Hall of Memories is the really nice unique fortune for Haven. Banish target friendly human creature, then take target angel creature from your hand and deploy it for free at the same position as the banished creature. Do I really have to say why it is good card, why is it powerful and stuff? Well, it's obviously you can use it to... it's free. First of all, it's free. So you can, like, drop some really, really weak human... well, most of the... I'm not gonna say that all, but most... at least most of the... well, definitely not all, because there are angels. But many of the Haven cards are humans anyway, so... especially those cheap ones. So you can drop like some sort of Wolf Trainer or whatever was his name. Or something else that is cheap. and change it into like your super mega overpowered angel, because angels are always overpowered and freaking expensive. And the second card is Mother Namtaru. We have two Mother Namtarus, which is the Asha's Nightmare and Invoker of Death, but on Friday we'll have Mother Namtaru Invoker of Death. So she has this discard the card, destroy target enemy creature with a cost of 2 or less for mere 1 resource. It's a decent ability. Not too overpowered, given that it can destroy only creatures with a cost of 2 or less. Nothing that is more expensive, aka more powerful. It costs her 1 resource and a card, so it's fairly balanced. Lots of magic schools, lots of magic, no destiny at all, though it can be worked around. And that's it regarding the Infernal Pit. And here comes the time of renewal. The long awaited, or actually not long awaited, but oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. At first I was like really mad about this expansion. The first I started reading into the patch notes and stuff, what it's gonna be about, I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Because basically, what is time of renewal? It's 170 new cards. Well, not entirely new. It's 170 cards introduced to standard format. But out of them, only 24 are new cards. And 146 cards are cards from previous base set 1, not only base set 1, but from the open format. So it's base set 1, it's Void Rising, Herald of the Void, Five Towers, and the one with Academy, Forgotten Wars, yeah. All of these expansions. So at the very beginning I was really skeptical about it. I was like, no way, ain't this ain't a good thing, you know, this is really gonna work out bad for us and stuff. But actually, the more I read into the patch notes, the more I felt that it's actually not that bad idea, and it may be actually really, really interesting. Well, I'm not gonna talk about the new cards, there is very little of them. If you are really interested, you can really check them on your own, but in my opinion, they are dot. I took a brief look at them, nothing too spectacular in my opinion. They are nice, I'm not saying that they are not nice, but I'm not gonna talk about them. I'm gonna talk about the rebalanced cards, because that was really interesting. So basically what we're having here, we're having the cards from the open format, from the base set 1 and subsequent expansions. As the devs say, they are being rebalanced. In my opinion, most of these cards, they are getting buffed. Yeah, basically buffed. There are a few cards that are getting nerfed, but they are mostly getting buffed. So let's go to the Altar of Wishes and we'll take a quick look at all the factions and all the changes. So first of all, we go with the Academy and the things that were changed with the Academy. So first of all, Dancing Dervish. Let's go with the Dancing, and here we see the Dancing Dervish. It's been nerfed. It's now cost 2, requirements 2. Well, basically the only thing that changed regarding the Dancing Dervish is it had its health increased by 1. So previously it had a health of 3. With a cost of 2, 4 health, range reflect 1, 2 attack, it makes it really powerful starting card for Academy. The other thing that goes with this Dervish is the Spinning Dervish. This is also getting modified, and Spinning Dervish is actually getting it let me take a look here, because I don't really remember. Spinning Dervish is getting its health increased by 2. It used to have only 4 health, now it has 6 health, with evade and range reflect too. It's still quite expensive, but really, really powerful card. Really, really, it really gets them worth using. The next thing we have here is the Enslaved Harpy. Enslaved Harpy is getting her health nerfed from 6 to 5, but on the other hand, she's getting her attack increased by 1. Really nice, decent starting flyer for Academy as well. It's cheap, low requirement, lots of health and decent damage. Makes them really, really good card to start your game off. Minotaur Brute. Minotaur. Minotaur Brute is getting its retaliation reduced from 2 to 1. But it's getting Shockwave 2 instead of what used to be Shockwave 1 before. Slight change, though it can really change a lot. Minotaur Brute is a powerful card, he's really tough. And actually, it's bullshit. I mean, because I'm reading from the patch notes and I'm not looking at the cards here. Yep, I am. And apparently, yeah, on patch notes it says that Minotaur Brute used to have 3 attack, 3 retaliation. Oh no, it's requirements that change. My bad. So it's getting its requirements reduced from 3 might and 2 magic to 3 might and 1 magic, which essentially allows you to drop them earlier in the game. Once again, it's a fairly powerful card and could really help you. Spellful Gene and Unstable Gene. Cell Spell Gene. So, Cell Spell Genes, I'm not going over all of the cards that are being changed, just to mention just a few most interesting, in my opinion. Excuse me, where was I? Yeah, sorry, I got lost in the patch notes. Just a second. We're at Cell Spell Gene. So Cell Spell Gene is getting his requirements reduced by 1 magic. It's a really, really interesting card that's quite tough. Lots of attack, quite a lot of health, and not that much, not that high cost. Well, of course, if you have 0 resource, deal 1 damage to your hero, that's a fairly bad thing. But still, he's quite powerful. The next gene that's getting changed is the Unstable Gene. Let's just say gene, it would be better from the beginning. And Unstable Gene, as far as I can remember, is the... Well, this is the Insettable Gene that's also getting changed, but I want the Unstable Gene. Which is this is Soul Consuming Ifrit, and here is the Unstable Gene. Unstable Gene is getting changed. He used to cost only 3, now he costs 4, a little bit more expensive, though he's getting his might requirement reduced by 1. He used to have 4, now he has only 3 might requirement. Magic requirement remains the same. Its stats, though, are changed from 4 attack to retaliation, 6 health, to 4 attack, 3 retaliation, 7 health. So more health and more retaliation, and now he's got Magic Channel 1. So, that's the thing. Also from the interesting cards, we're having... We're having Wizard Tutor and Wizard Disciples. These are the cards that were in the... were in the whatever it's called. In the standard format already, but they are getting also slightly changed, so I'm mentioning those cards as well. No, this is Scholar. Here is Wizard Tutor. Wizard Tutor is getting his requirements changed from... Yep. Am I looking good? And it's bullshit again. He's getting his requirements set to 1 and 1. Okay, I don't know why it crashed, but I realized that it's not recording when I was already at Necropolis, so we'll have to go back and take a quick round around the thing that I've already said, but it wasn't recorded. So the Wizard Tutor is listed as to have his stats changed from 1 and 2 to 2 and 1, but apparently his requirements. But apparently he's having 1 and 1, so that's one thing. The other thing I was going to mention is the Wizard Disciple, which is having... I have to find, as I mentioned before, I'm reading it off the official patch notes. The Wizard Disciple has requirement magic requirement reduced from 2 to 1. And basically the last thing I was going to mention... Arcane Archer goes back, no changes, just goes back. This is a really nice powerful shooter creature for Academy. And also Chronicler is getting changed. He used to have requirements of 1-1-2, now he's having 2-1-1, and there were all changes. No, and he's having his attack improved by 1, making him slightly more useful. Now let's go to Inferno. We have Hellhounds for the Inferno, that's the first thing. Hellhounds are getting increased with the upgraded with the stackable ability, and they are really nice starting card for Inferno. That's pretty much what I said before it crashed. I mean after it crashed, but I wasn't aware that it's crashed. So that's the one thing, really nice starter card, useful. The other thing for Inferno that's getting changed is the Hellfire Juggernaut. Wait a minute. Okay, I was checking if by the chance Haven was recorded, but no, Haven wasn't recorded, so we also have to go over Haven. And oh crap, I've been talking a lot regarding Haven, and I'm starting to feel my throat a little bit sore. But basically, Hellfire Juggernaut is going back. He's getting Fire Burst 4, he used to have Fire Burst 2. And he's getting added this ability: when Hellfire Juggernaut attacks and destroys the creature, overkill damage is redirected to enemy hero. With 7 damage, he's ultra powerful but low on health. Keep in mind that spells that could protect him from damage will be really useful. The Lacerator or something like this, yep, is also going back with slight change. He's getting Area Blast 3, I think he used to have Area Blast 2, nope. Lacerator, he's getting his cost reduced from 5 to 4, he's getting his might requirement reduced from 5 to 4, he's now a magic melee shooter instead of being just magic melee, and he's trading 1 retaliation for 1 more health. He used to have 3 retaliation and 5 health. So that's it, and I'm not gonna talk about Inferno a lot. 4, I don't really feel the need to, but there is one card that needs to be mentioned. This card that was already in standard format, but is being changed, is the Spawning Chamber. As far as I can remember, Spawning Chamber used to work like... I think it was add plus 3 to the... If there's a breeder stack at the end of your turn, if there's a breeder stack, add plus 3 to this stack or something like this. Now, if there's a breeder stack with 10 or less size, a Spawning Chamber double its stack size. This is getting insane, this is getting ultra overpowered to some extent. I mean, in the early game, this is underpowered because, you know, getting increased by 3 was better if you had only one stack than doubling the amount. But if you're able to crank up like to, I don't know, like 3, 6, 9, or even this 10, this 10 is the max number that it will still work. So if you have like those stupid little breeder token creatures with 101, if you'll be able to grind up a 10 on these and your enemy will recklessly leave it open, then it will double up to 20, it will have 20 damage. One stack with 20 damage, this is insane. 20 health also, so it's impossible to wipe out for dealing 20 damage in one blow. Almost impossible. And it will be able to destroy any given creature or even any given hero in just one attack after this thing happens. Though it will not upgrade your stacks infinitely, because with the previous Spawning Chamber you could grind up a stack of even 100 or something like this. But no more. Okay. And we're back to heaven. I'm really, really sad that it did not record what I was saying about heaven, because as I've mentioned, I was talking quite a lot about the heaven creatures. So, my favorite Imperial Sentinels are going back to the game, now with stackable. No other changes except they are now stackable. They are really powerful, cheap creature for the early game for Haven. Also, they have Melee Guard. I wonder if the Melee Guard will stack. If I have a stack of 2, will they have Melee Guard of 2? If so, they will be really freaking difficult to be destroyed by the melee creatures. Especially that melee guard guards all the adjacent creatures as well. Also, the Imperial Crossbowmen that were already in standard format now are also stackable. Really, really nice. Honestly, there are two factions that I'm really satisfied when it comes to this improvement in the new patch. And this is Haven and Necropolis. So we're over Haven now, and we'll jump to the Necropolis just in a second. The other cards that come back to the game are the Devoted Sisters. And Devoted Sisters are getting really, really buffed. First of all, they're having more health, more attack, more retaliation, more health, and let me just make sure. Yep, that's it. So now they're becoming a really, really powerful healers. With one attack and one retaliation, they are no longer useless. With 4 health, that's not a huge change, but it's still significant change, so they are more likely to survive a little bit longer. With heal 2, they can be a really, really powerful asset in your hand. Griffin. Griffin. And Griffin Battle Priest is getting changed. Now Griffin Battle Priest has one more health. It used to have only 4. Now it has 5. So again, powerful healing creature is getting even more powerful. What we also have there is the Sun Crusader. Come on. He used to have cost 6, now he costs only 5. He used to have requirement of 6 might, now has only 5. He no longer regenerates because he used to have regeneration something, I don't remember. But instead he's gaining this powerful ability. The first time a friendly knight creature destroys a creature during your turn, increase the size of all friendly stacks by 1. So again, nice addition if you're building a stacks-centered Haven deck. Also, he's freaking tough and powerful as well. And last but not least, one of my favorite Haven cards, pre-base set 2. Now it comes back. Actually, I failed. Almost comebacks, because I was in love with Radiant Glories. Radiant Glories used to be the core creature in the every Haven deck you could possibly build before base set 2. They were cheap, tough, powerful, not that demanding when it comes to requirements. Unluckily, they are not going back. Radiant Glories are going back with slight changes to them as well. They have now only regenerate 2 instead of regenerate 3. Also, they have cost reduced to 5. They have requirements changed from 5 might to only 4 might, but they gain this super duper ultra mega powerful special ability. Whenever a friendly creature is healed, it gains plus 1 attack until end of turn. You're building a powerful self-healing deck that is almost impossible to destroy because everything is healing everything, and you have something like this which makes everything when healed even more powerful. OP. Okay, so that's more or less all regarding Haven. Now let's go for Necro. And Necro, as I said, really, really nice improvements to the Necro cards. First of all, Skeleton Spearmans. No changes except now it's stackable. Really, really powerful early game card for Necropolis. Really useful asset, especially to drop in your back lane. Back row, back line, whatever, back column. And the other thing that goes back is the Plague Skeleton. Like, these two, Plague Skeleton and Skeleton Spearman, like, pre-base set 2, they were like basic Necropolis' firepower. Because Necropolis has many, many, many melee creatures, and these were two really cheap and fairly powerful shooter creatures. This one, especially with Infect, I think that Infect stacks, just like on the Venom Soldiers, I'm not sure. I'm not sure if even the Infect stacks on the Venom Soldiers. But if Infect stacks, well, they can get really powerful. Okay. Okay, I'm really feeling a sore throat, because, like, I've been telling all of this stuff, but now I realize that I was almost done with the freaking Necropolis, and I realized that everything went down. Putrid Dragon is, I think he's getting his cost reduced by 1. So that's by the way, but what I wanted to say is that... I'm just checking if it's still working. The Rotting Zombie, he's getting his cost reduced from 4 to 2. Now he puts 2 poison counters on all creatures on the same row instead of putting only 1. And he's losing 1 retaliation and 1 health. So that's regarding the Rotting Zombie. What else do we have? Ghouls. Many changes to ghouls. So let's type in ghoul. And, first of all, Ravenous Ghouls are coming back to game. Sorry. Now they are from Earth School of Magic. They are melee shooters now. They have regenerate 1. They used to have regenerate 2. Now they have only regenerate 1. But they also gain infect 1. And they have their health increased by 1. That's the one thing. The next thing is the Putrid Ghoul. Which also gains the School of Earth. He's getting his health increased by 1 and he's gaining 3 retaliation. He used to have none. And he's gaining Infect 1. And instead of having that his attack is equal to the number of poison counter on friendly creatures. It used to have that the attack of that thing is equal to the poison counters on it. Now its attack is equal to the number of poison counters on all friendly creatures. So really powerful. The next ghoul that's also coming back and getting changed is the Albattle Ghoul. And the only change regarding this one is that it's getting Infect 1. So you can really, really start to build a really freaking powerful poison-focused Necropolis deck right now. What else? Oh, we were at zombies and I forgot to mention it. The Plague Zombie is getting slightly changed as it's getting one more health. Really, really nice addition, making this card even more powerful, like it was ever a weak card. Putrid Lamassu is getting a change, which are his stats. This freaking overpowerful thing is getting 2 more health. Now it used to have only 6, now it has 8. It was overpowered, now it's even more overpowered. Keep in mind that it's freaking expensive, but this is ultra powerful. And the one nice thing that changes regarding Necropolis is Vampire. Like this, Vampire, where is he? Vampire Lord. And he's getting his might requirement reduced to 5, he used to have 6. Phew, I think that's more or less everything about Necros I wanted to say. Regarding Stronghold, there's been some changes to Stronghold, but honestly, in my opinion, nothing really interesting. So I'm gonna skip it and go straight to the Sanctuary. So first of all, here comes this Shinobi Blackmailer. It's actually what used to be Naga Tactician. Now it's classified as Naga Spy. And it has the first time a friendly spy creature deals combat damage to enemy hero during your turn, increase your resource production by 1. There was... Oh, and it's also getting its health increased by 1. Naga Tactician had only 2 health, this has 3 health. There is some sort of a fortune, I don't remember the name, for Sanctuary, which essentially makes that when your spies attack enemy hero, you get your resource production increased. So that's the one thing. Waterfall Guardians are getting buffed. Sorry for the, oh my god, that was a crime. Waterfall Guardians no longer are encored and no longer cannot attack. Now they can attack and they are not encored, and also they getting 1 more retaliation. They used to have only 1, so they are still typical tank, not much of a fighting creature, rather to block a lane, but it's getting even more powerful. And it remains with the Hypnotize, which can be really helpful. Naga, screw the bullshit. I'm gonna find him. No, it's a Shinji Warrior. Naga Warrior. With changes... First of all, reduced cost from 6 to 4. Second of all, reduced might requirement from 6 to 4. Also, reduced retaliation from 3 to 1. No, wait, not this one. Reduced health from 7 to 6. His retaliation and attack remain the same. And he's getting honor 1 instead of honor 2, so... Instead of being really powerful but not really a popular creature, it's probably gonna become a little bit more popular given his lowered cost and requirements, but he won't be as powerful as he used to be. And one last returning card is Kappa. Not Kappa-Shoya. Kappa-Shoya is also returning, but I'd rather mention the regular Kappa. Here it is. And regular Kappa is returning with no changes at all. Kappa-Shoya, if we're at it, Kappa-Shoya gains reduced cost by 1, reduced might requirements by 1, does not have focused blast anymore, but gets outmaneuver. If we're at Kappas, dosing Kappa is getting slightly changed. By slightly changed, we mean that dosing Kappa has now only requirement of 1 magic instead of 2. Snow Maidens are also getting changed. Snow Maidens used to have 2 attack, 1 retaliation and 4 health. Now they have 5 health, so they are getting slightly tougher. Also Sayama Warden is getting changed, whereas its requirements are, its destiny requirement is reduced by 1. It used to be 3, now it's only 2. It's a really powerful creature that's again is getting more accessible. And oh well, well, Shark Protectors are getting changed. Basically, they no longer require destiny. Yeah, right? Right, yeah, I'm good at reading. Okay, so that's all the factions. Now the only thing we have left are the neutral creatures, and once again we're having a return of one of my favorite base set 1 cards, the Power Hunter. Power Hunter now comebacks to the game with stackable and increased health by 1. Rogue Mercenaries, I'm not gonna go to them, are getting their stats increased. Rogue Mercenary is having now 2 bullshit again with those patch notes. It says that he's getting increased to 2 retaliation, but from what I can see here he's getting only 1 retaliation. Fair enough, he's getting some retaliation. He used to have Halexian Librarian. Librarian is getting 1 attack. He used to have no attack, now he has 1 attack. Cactus Thing. Cactus Thing is getting its health increased by 1. Really, really interesting. Tank kind of thing. Blind Brothers come back to the game with more attack, more retaliation and more health, plus 1 to all of these stats. And one card that I really liked, that I was using in my Necropolis deck, really nice card, Lesser Shadow Elemental, with changes, with reduced requirements. That's are his changes. Regarding the other changes to the existing cards, like all the elementals had some changes to them. Oh my god, I have 22 air elementals. By the gods. I'm not gonna go over all of the elemental changes. Mostly buffs. It's just they were all... they were all buffed. Also, Anael, Chosen of the Light, now requires only... now requires only 5 might instead of 6. And Hasafash. Wait, I'm not sure which one. I think it's this one. Hasafash, chosen of the shadows, now requires only 2 magic instead of 3. Oh, so that's the changes to the neutral creatures. I'm not gonna go over the changes regarding the fortunes. Most fortunes were not changed at all. They were just enhanced. I mean, they were just reintroduced to the game. But we have spells, and first of all, Agony comes back to the game. And the change regarding Agony is that now it costs only 1 and has only requirement of magic 1, so it can be really nasty. Ugh. What do we have else? Ice Walls come back to the game with, I think, no changes at all. Weakness with no changes at all. Yeah, I know the double S. No changes? Yep, weakness comes with no changes. Chain heal again with no changes. I'll find it. Chain heal, 3 damage from 2 target creatures. No changes. What else do we have there? I think there are all that used to be in there, but come now. The not ice wall, but rather the ice spikes are getting their magic requirement reduced by 1. The lightning burst and fire burst. The lightning burst and fire burst. Where is it? Or is it magma burst? Oh, sorry, magic blast. Lightning burst and blast. And fire blast are getting magic requirement reduced to 2. It used to be 3. And also lightning. Shade Lightning is getting its magic requirement reduced to 3, and so does Lightning Bolt. Okay, that's the changes to the... Oh my god. To the spells. Now, quickly talking about the heroes. The heroes that come back are... Ghazal, Lady of Secrets, I think. With her ability now being cheaper. Siegfried comes back with a modified ability. I'm too tired, honestly. Flippin' hell. Jezreel is getting changed ability. Zorm is coming back with a changed ability. My throat aches. Masfor, he's getting his ability cost reduced to 0. I don't remember how much it was. Nuburu is getting his abilities cost reduced. I think it used to be 6. Matewa is getting insanely overpowered with even cheaper. Right? Or was it? Yep, ability cost is reduced. And actually, there is one last really thing that I want to mention. Regarding the Necropolis heroes, that's why I'm setting it up like this. Because that's what I was always mentioning, that Flesh Bane deck, the Incorporeal Flesh Bane deck. Well, Incorporeal Flesh Bane deck is no longer a thing. For Flesh Bane and Svetlana. No, sorry, not Svetlana. Svetlana? Yeah, Svetlana. Flesh Bane and Svetlana are getting their abilities changed. So now Flesh Bane can take the target vampire creature card with a requirement of 3 might or less from your graveyard and deploy it for free. While Svetlana, Hero Fan of the Spider Queen, now has an ongoing bonus plus 1 health to all incorporeal creatures. Oh, well, I think I forgot to mention the I don't know. Oh, I know why. I thought that maybe I'm fucking up with the spelling again, but it's just the fact that Lingering Ghost is getting changes. Let me just find on the patch notes. Lingering Ghost is getting one more base health. He used to have 2, now he has 3. And the Vengeful Spectre, I think it's the same kind of change. Nope, Vengeful Spectre is getting increased attack and retaliation. Though still on Svetlana, they are really tough and they are getting even tougher. It will be a real pain in the ass for non-magical deck to deal with them then. Oh boy. I think we've been over everything now. I think it's long enough and I'm not gonna drop any duel today. I'm just gonna say what I did last week, which was basically grinding up monies, if you have realized before. If not, just take a look at how many money I had at the last of the previous video and how much money I have now. It's like I have like twice as much or so. Oh, of course, I forgot to mention really important stuff, which is well, first of all, other changes to the UI, many more animation. If you've played since Time of Renewal, you'll see them. If you haven't played, well, I'm not gonna show it now because it's already too late. That's why I don't really want to record on Wednesday, but just it so happens I'll have to finish this video soon, for I'll be leaving. Oh well. Anyway, really nice animations in-game. You'll see them if we'll play. Oh, the cardback themes, should I mention them? You can have a custom cardback, which is basically you can buy it for a limited time for gold. Why would you waste your gold on such a thing? Or you can buy it permanently, but with seals. That's bullshit. If it will be to buy for gold to be permanent, then maybe I'll buy myself one, like Necropolis one or anyone. But in my opinion, a little bit too expensive and not worth it. Now let's take a look at the shop. I've grinded a lot of money because I wanted to... I'm not gonna buy anything right now, but as soon as Time of Renewal will be available for gold, which actually may be today, I'm not sure, but when Time of Renewal will be available for gold, I'm buying 10 packs of the thing, and we're gonna make a once again grand opening, and we'll fill a bit with deck building. Also, when the expansion came live, it fucked up my ranking, so I was down to 90%. I've managed to... I was over this 24%. But then I went down. Nope, Time of Renewal still not available for gold. I've grinded up this much because the regular packs cost 15,000. A pack. I think that when the Time of Renewal will be available for gold, they will cost 20,000 per pack, so that will be just enough to have 10 packs bought. That's why I've grinded so much of the stuff. Of course, I still forgot to mention this. There are new abilities added to the game. They come with the new creatures that I'm not mentioning today. These abilities are Perfect Retaliation, which means that damage from the retaliation damage from the creature cannot be prevented in any way. So screw all your shields and stuff. The other new ability that goes is Armor, where I think only one creature I saw with armor, one stronghold creature seems to have armor, and it removes the X, where X is the number near the armor for damage from combat damage dealt to this creature. So it's like a bit like Combat Guard, though Combat Guard also affects adjacent creatures, while this thing affects only the creature that has this armor X. It reduces the X damage from combat damage dealt to this creature. We have also Poison Heal, which is basically whenever poison counters are on your creature, instead of damaging it, they are healing it for the same amount. And one last thing that is a total bullshit, as like I've been facing it already and it's so much difficult to bear with it. It goes for spells and it's persistent. When enchanted creature leaves play, the spell enchants a random adjacent creatures from the same side if possible. So basically you have this like combustion, I think it is. Yeah, combustion. Like someone drops this thing on you and it's jumping from one to other creature. It's like I was having a little problem with that thing up until it landed on something that I had magic resist on, and it was fancy because it was like dealing zero damage every turn, and it wasn't able to move because that thing was magic resistant, so every damage was reduced by half rounded down, so one half rounded down equals zero. And there are quite a few cards with this bonus. Also, many new achievements came to game that helped me get this much money. I'm not sure. Where are they? Yeah, somewhere right here. So, get into game 1, 2, 3 and many other numbers. Play 5 minutes for 2,000 gold, 10 minutes for 5,000 gold. It's like I was browsing shop and suddenly I see the notification that I've just unlocked an achievement. I'm like, what the fuck? I take a look and oh my god, new achievements. I have almost ignored it. Congratulations, you unlocked new to the shop, buy base set 2-pack. Oh, that's actually what I did off-camera. I bought one base set 2-pack and
opened it. So, yeah, for buying this pack and opening it, you gain 15,000 gold, which is as much as you'd pay for a pack, so it's like one pack free. Edit your deck. That was like totally ridiculous. I just added one card to the deck and then removed it from the deck. So no changes at all were made, but it counted as creating. Congratulations, you unlocked Get It in the Game 3. 30 minutes for 15,000 gold, so one more pack for free. 60 minutes, 30,000 gold, that's a lot. Congratulations, you finished the daily quest. That's what I said, I was grinding some gold, so I finished daily quests. Congratulations, you unlocked the first new deck, create a new deck for standard format. 5 wildcards. So yeah, I just pressed new deck, put some random cards just so it fit, and then I deleted the deck, nothing interesting. And, oh, actually, this one is old for reaching the level 25. Even more gold. Oh, now you have this fancy thing. If you go to details regarding your quests, you can see the details regarding your achievements. Complete the Herald of the Void campaign. Get a card from Altar of Wishes. So, hey, why don't we do it? What card from Altar of Wishes do I really, really want? I want... Actually, this will be probably the first time I'll be using Altar of Wishes. Something that is rare. And something that is powerful. Maybe something from Time of Renewal. Let's start from the cheapest ones. The heroes. The staff. Oh, of course, it's not showing how much I have from the... Oh, even if I hide duplicate, it's not helping at all. I don't know what I want to have more of. I really, really don't know. Sahar mummies are coming back to the game. I don't know. I really don't know, and oh my god. It's like, given that I was recording like one thing twice. Ah, my throat is really sore. Vestal. Hello. I think they may be actually new to the game. Blind Justicar. There were the cards I used to want to possess. But they were expensive cards. The Ghost Dragon is having his costs reduced or something, or requirements reduced. I don't know exactly, but some sort of buff definitely. Oh, also you get a quick look at the cards. Oh, I haven't mentioned that the Threads of Fate are coming back and the Cyclone is coming back. Really, really nasty, yet powerful spell. Gold mines there were. Oh, you can take a brief look at those cards since I'm scrolling. They're trying to spot something interesting. Nothing interesting. Honestly, nothing interesting. Let's do select all, but let's say I want only epics. What epics do I want? Maybe more Griffin Battle Priests.
for the mere cost of 8. Okay, it crashed again on me, so it wasn't a good day. Well, basically, what you haven't seen, I hope that you will see, is I took the whatever it's called. I took the Banshee from the Infernal Pit, from the Altar of Wishes, because I realized that I have no Banshees, and Banshees are our thing. Worth adding to your incorporeal deck, and I plan on getting one like this in the future. So I have the quest finished here. Now when I go to the beginner, it offers me nothing. Oh, anyway, yeah, many talking that has not recorded. My sore throat, oh my god. It's really, really bad for my throat. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this really, really long summary of Time of Renewal. If, hopefully, the Time of Renewal will be available for gold soon. When it happens, we're buying 10 packs, unpacking them, and we'll have an episode dedicated to deck building. For the time being, thanks for watching, guys. Once again, I hope you enjoyed. If you did, like, share, subscribe, comment. Yeah, why don't you bother and write in comment your one favorite card that came in the Time of Renewal, or that was changed in Time of Renewal, where, well, basically one thing from time that was changed in Time of Renewal that you like the most. I personally really like the animations that unluckily you hadn't seen today. Hopefully you'll see them in next week's video. And regarding the cards, I think I'm most happy with the return of Devoted Sisters and how they were upgraded. Anyway, yeah. Put in comments what you enjoyed about the new expansion the most. So we'll have something to talk about in the meantime, waiting for the next week's episode. Once again, thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you next week for more Might and Magic Duel of Champions. See you.